Welcome back, everyone, to theCUBE coverage here in Las Vegas for AWS reInvent 2024. I'm John Furrier, your host of theCUBE. You know, we're here getting all the action. We've got the keynotes going off, a lot of experts coming through theCUBE. We got the newsmakers, the top executives. Check out siliconangle.com, of course, cube.net. We've got a great story here from people, you know, in the trenches, building, engineering the solutions. Also, a customer of a company we've been covering, which is one of the fastest growing startups in the decade, Cribl. Scott is software engineering, and then Pedro, who is security engineer at Siemens. You guys are customers. You guys are practitioners. You're basically doing it. You're making it happen. Thanks for coming on theCUBE.
Thanks for having us.
So reInvent. This is a conference where everyone goes crazy. Where the keynote is so long, but it's chock full of like every word is like another announcement. DSQL, you know, tabular database, data lakes going on steroids with new capabilities, security as a service, all the slew of announcements, of course, the Gen AI, but just real infrastructure advantage. So starting to see a lot more energy into the infrastructure, and then now the data piece is flowing, because the data is not stopping, and Cribl has been a key part of that. So first of all, what do you guys do? Explain what your jobs are, then I want to dig into some of the use cases. Scott, let's start with you.
Okay. I'm a software engineering senior manager. A team that we're leading up is a security team. It's internally known as a SIEM engineering and tooling team. We're responsible for building out our Splunk environment and setting up automation, third-party tooling, and things like that. And Pedro's an engineer on my team.
So I'm a senior security engineer on Scott's team. Mainly dealing with the Splunk engineering and architecture side of things, along with all the end-to-end visibility in our infrastructure environment, which we use Cribl for.
Yeah, when Cribl was a startup, I knew the founders before they started, so we followed the journey. And it's really one of those incredible stories where they just solve a great problem, pain point. And that pain point a lot of people had, but also it lined up with the market, right? That everyone's like, okay, wow, growth of data. So like, they just accelerated. So what do you guys like about Cribl? If you had to kind of boil down why Cribl, why you guys use Cribl?
From my perspective, it's about the data reduction, that we now have visibility into our environment like we never had before. We didn't have the licensing capacity, you know, for our Splunk environment to ingest all the different logs that we were interested in. But Security Lake really allowed us to start collecting those. And then it was a matter of, okay, now what do we do with that data?
Yeah,
we couldn't take 5 terabytes of data and throw it into our Splunk environment as is. But Cribl allowed us to reduce a lot of the data, eliminate fields that weren't of importance to us, do some summarization upon it. And as a result of that, we were able to do a 90 to 95% reduction of the data.
So your core problem was multifold. What's the visibility of the data look like? And two, I got to pay out the nose for Splunk.
Exactly.
And it's like, okay.
Yeah.
Like, okay. I don't yet know what I'm going to get. So why am I, it's one of those things, right? You just do the product right. Yeah, we've heard that story many times. Okay, let's get into the security lake piece, because now, okay, we're hearing a lot of stories around, okay, I use AI, I use tools to help me understand what I got, solve some pain points, and then there's an eureka moment. Whoa, wow, look at this. We're seeing things and then acting on them. Can you guys share any examples of what came next? Obviously, clearly, old way versus the new way explained, but was there an illumination of like, okay, let's start doing things differently with the data? Can you share any like examples of how this played out in the day in the life of as you guys operate this?
Yeah, I mean, so we learned about Security Lake and its features and how it could very easily aggregate all this highly valuable, you know, valuable to security and observability and other components, but certainly for security data. But then when it came to like, how do we actually get at this data? You know, that's where Cribl came in. We were able with Cribl Stream, which now I know that Cribl just got their Amazon Security Lake competency as both a subscriber and a producer. So they used to be able to write to Security Lake. Now they can actually read from it, which is the part that we're mostly using. Gives us the flexibility of getting the data out of Security Lake, and as Scott was saying, reducing it, but transforming it such that we, because there were a lot of fields that we didn't necessarily care about, a lot of events that were, you know, like let's say 10 events describing similar behavior. Now we can summarize that before sending it to Cribl, or to Splunk rather, and not just Security Lake, other components too. Cribl just gives us that flexibility of making the data look the way we want to, as far as the format that we are expecting, that our analysts are used to, so that it's more usable to them.
Yeah, it reminds me of the story, Scott, we mentioned, when you get a clean house, just get clean up, get up all the rooms, get everything set up, Security Lake does that, the new version. You mentioned the competency certification. That's cool, it kind of gets to the next level. And then how's this impacting the modernization on the SIM side? As you look at migrations, there's a lot of SIM activity going on. Does that play into this?
Well, for us, it was the, just that enhanced visibility. Amazon Security Lake makes it so that at the organization level, we can collect all these logs in a central location. But now with Cribl, now our analysts have easy access to all this data. Now we can populate all these great dashboards that Splunk provides, all the, be able to run detections like a normal day to day. They don't have to pivot to another tool. They can just stay where they're at and continue to do their
talk about
their
that pivot to another tool. That's come up a lot, like as a pain in the, I don't want to just go to another tool because I got a bought a vendor's wares, right? This is where you feel like it's jammed down your throat. It's like gun to your head. I don't want to do that. What's the real impact of that? Because that's disruption.
Absolutely. And I think one of the things for us is we've really utilized Splunk as the platform that we built everything around. And that's really where we send our users. So we're a centralized security team, and we have dozens of development teams that are internal clients. And we utilize that Splunk platform for our clients to access. So we're constantly creating dashboards, reports, various searches for them. And it's just really a one-stop shop for our customers.
On the security operations side, what is the current state of the art for modernization? If you guys had to look at where the Cribl dynamic comes in, or just in general data management, how are you guys seeing this? What does state of the art mean to you? Like, is it the platform? Is it the tooling? Is it just the consistency in the data? If someone said, define a security ops data modernization, what would you say? Like, how would you describe that?
Like, traditionally, there was very little means of modifying the data before it got to your SIM. You had to build your own sort of tooling around it, or you just had to, if whatever vendor had, whatever their data looked like, that's what ended up in the SIM, and that worked. But as the volume of data grows, as the, the licensing, it's not like it gets cheaper.
Yeah.
Now with a tool like Cribl, the way modernization looks like for us is now we don't have to settle for whatever the vendors give us. Not that, there's good reasons for why they build it the way they build it, but now we can really transform it and only get the things that we care about and that are relevant, not just to our SOC, but like Scott said, to our internal operations teams, dev teams, and they can get full access to the data as opposed to having to pivot to like a different tool to get access to the data where it lives.
So usability is key for the ops team, but you just said reduction of data was a real value.
Absolutely.
That's value, because then you got quality. You're not overstuffing data into the SIM or other mechanisms.
Absolutely.
All right, what's the big takeaway from reInvent this year for you guys? Are you guys in the hallway conversations? This is one of those events. So I was with someone from another company, I won't say their name, because but they're doing a deal with AWS. It was her first time at reInvent. She goes, I go, where's everyone going? Is there like a concert? I go, no, it's the keynote. Keynote at 8:30? Yeah, it's Peter DeSantis, it's the infrastructure keynote. They're still going? Like, this company's had never seen the conference where people are going to keynotes at 8:30, right? So they've just never been, and so she was blown away. So there's always hallways, it's still late night. I mean, everyone, there's meetings, see friends here. What have you guys learned so far here at reInvent? Any observations, takeaways, hallway conversations that you've seen and heard?
I mean, for me, it's all about the engagement and the networking. I've been here as an attendee many times.
Yeah.
I sat in line for hours on end to get into a session. But I think I find real value in meeting with our clients, our internal customers, our suppliers, our vendors.
Yeah.
That's really where I find a lot of value. And we've had the opportunity already to speak with several different product development teams on AWS side and some of our other businesses that we work with, like Cribl. We've had a lot of exchanges with them. And it's just been really valuable as far as all the things that are coming down the line and things that we can take advantage of.
It's a wired community here. people are wired up together, all online.
Right.
They come here for the confab, see each other. Anything on your end, Pedro, that you'd like to share?
For me, it's Gary. You know, in a way, I like getting carried away with the hype. You know, so that I get excited, riled up, get some of my new ideas of what other teams are. You know, how other teams are solving these problems. So that when we get back to our home offices, we can hopefully implement some of that in our environment.
Yeah, I'm 12 years in, and you know, 10 years ago, I could stay out till 2 a.m. and get some scoops and some good content. I'm in bed by 11:30. Okay, I try for 11:30, but it's just a great conference. It is. I mean, I don't get to go to these sessions. I don't have the time, but you know, I get a lot of the CUBE interviews. But again, the change of pace of play right now in this business is probably at an all-time high I've seen, and it's putting a lot of pressure on people and teams. As you guys look at that, at your teams and your teammates, what's some of the things is that that you guys do to chill, to relax, to kind of absorb and still run as fast as you do? What are some of the things that you guys do, whether it's coping mechanisms or just strategies? You know, like what do you, because I mean, people are running hard right now and it's fun. It's, you know, it's not a boring time. You know, but you got insecurity, you got inbounds coming in, but you got technology coming in. What's the, what do you guys share to other folks out there watching? I feel like we're in lie down on the couch and
yeah. One thing that I really like how our team does is that we don't tend to rush to implement the latest and greatest right away. We take the time to really understand what the applicable use cases are for us, what problems we're trying to solve, and then we try to put processes around it and make sure we are actually using the tool or the whatever the technology is before we start looking at the next thing. Because otherwise, you know, leads to burnout, leads to, you know, doing too much at once or poorly implemented things. Yeah. I mean, not for everybody, but certainly for us, one of the things I like that we do and we do well, I think, is implement, you know, take our time, do things right before we move on.
Yeah, and you guys got a great reputation, good quality. Any thoughts just to close this out?
One of the things that, you know, I'll say is that, you know, we're a relatively small team, but we're distributed. You know, we're all across the states. And one of the things that I really enjoy is being able to get our team together every so often for team workshops, doing hackathons, whatever it may be. But it's really the camaraderie, you know, and the culture that we've established is just, it's awesome. You know,
I love the people. Just get the face-to-face going on. And then remote work is fine as long as you get together and keep nurturing the relationship.
Exactly.
It's a team takes a team to win. Guys, thanks so much for sharing. Appreciate you coming to CUBE. Thanks to Cribl for bringing you in. Really appreciate your time. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, more CUBE coverage here at reInvent. We'll be right back. I'm John Furrier, host of theCUBE. We'll be right back.